has styled an entire generation of world's most famous faces, including royalty, movie stars, and pop icons. Born in June 1958, Nicky grew up in South London to an English father and a Greek mother. His fascination with hairdressing began in his early teens, and he began his career at the age of 16, assisting John Frieda at legendary hairdressers House of Leonard. He went on to complete his apprenticeship in a record 10 months instead of the usual 3 years. Clarke achieved his first vogue spread in just 18 years old. He left House of Leonard 2 years later in 1976 under the tutelage of John Frieda to work at the John Frieda Clifford Stafford Salon in Marylebone. Since opening his first salon in 1991 in Mayfair, he's expanded his empire to include salons in Birmingham and Manchester and a globally successful hair care brand. His passion for hairdressing has made Nicky an international icon with an OBE awarded in 2008 in recognition to his services to the British hairdressing industry. So we've got a short clip here which we'd like you to watch now.
He wants to do something about his own hair before he starts messing with everyone else's. What are you looking at?
Nicky Clarke, or is it that bottle?
He started from nothing.
Really, just the idea that I wanted to do something in fashion. I mean, I went to a local grammar school in South London, but I didn't do particularly well. I mean, I got a couple of A-levels, GCSEs, call them today. But really, I didn't know really what I wanted to do. I really didn't kind of have any idea. Somebody had suggested doing hairdressing, which I have to say, back in 1974, was not what you would call an obvious choice, particularly. But, you know, they had said that, you know, either you go to a college or you could go to a really good salon and really just start at the bottom. I started, you know, sweeping up and, you know, pins and, you know, all that stuff. And I think after the first few months, of which I was pretty much mostly terrified every day, because I had no idea that, you know, this was pre... you know, being able to see anything on YouTube. This was pre being able to kind of, I think, for young guys, even to know, I mean, I didn't know what encoding was. And, but it was kind of a fascinating time because that time of the early 70s, from a history point of view, was a very interesting time for fashion, and certainly in terms of men's fashion. I think, you know, we'd just come through that whole kind of glam rock thing of 72, 73. And actually, you know, the 70s for me was far from the decade that style forgot, as everybody talks about. It was actually probably one of the most interesting, you know, because it really had so many different things, you know, in terms of the idea of glam rock in the early part. Then we had punk rock and disco running towards the middle of the 70s, and then the new wave, and then we have the new romantics and stuff in the late 70s. So it's a very, you know, interesting time. And I think that was my kind of, that was my intro from a fashion point of view. So I don't really know what else I could have done, actually.
Well, that leads me on to my second question, which was you undertook an apprenticeship, which you excelled at and finished very quickly. And how important has education been for you?
I mean, I think it is very, I mean, I think it's really important. I think hairdressing is probably one of the few careers that still has that kind of slightly old-fashioned aspect of an apprenticeship. But you know, you have to remember how apprenticeships really started. I mean, you know, years and years ago, you know, your parents or your guardian would have paid an employer to take you. You know, and you were then paying back. And then, of course, it's then become to that point where, well, they'll take you, but they're not really paying you that much. But I think it's £12 a week. And then it's there, but now, obviously, we have a slightly different aspect. But the integral part of going somewhere and learning, I think, is just wonderful. I mean, and the whole idea of vocational jobs, and whether that be in the beauty industry or not, I mean, I'm all for, you know, I'm very much the case of if you start at the bottom, there's only one way, and it's only
up. And speaking about that, when you were first starting out, and you were at the bottom, as it were, so you were working for Vogue when you were 18, were you intimidated by that context and the people around you? How did you approach that if you were intimidated?
Yeah, I mean, I was a bit, because I was actually scared of what to do, but these were slightly different times. I mean, you know, I was very, very blessed and fortunate to be able to be working with very, very good people. So, I mean, you know, the Vogue job seems kind of odd because why would Vogue be booking an 18-year-old? But actually, the idea was in those days that they didn't really want outsiders. They really wanted the So they felt comfortable. They'd met me before, you know. So I think it was, you know, it sounds incredibly impressive when you see it, and it is true. But you know, straight after that, you're kind of starting at the bottom again, and then having to work back up again. But it was an interesting time, and for me, it wasn't really. It was really more about not wanting to make a fool of myself. Right? I really wanted to be able to do something well. But the interesting thing is that those pictures that have languished in my tear sheets and become slightly yellowing from 40 years ago, you know, it's amazing how now you just rescan them and reprint them and they look really fresh. And actually, you know, they stand up against some of my later pictures. That's actually, you might say, but we'll see in the film later, it's actually there and it doesn't look that out of place.
No. Do you have any horror stories from when you were first starting out in terms of, I don't know, people not treating you so well because you were, I don't know, just starting out? Do you?
I think the thing is that it was a massive social jump for me. You know, I came from a council house in Yolkett Road, and then we moved to the Elephant Castle. And so the whole idea of mixing with people that were either very successful, very talented, or very well to do was quite alien to me. And so I think from that point of view, it was, you know, there were interesting times. I can't say that there was any disasters, because there was almost a point of, I knew where I was. And I don't mean that in a putting myself down way. I knew that I was a junior. And I see it now with some of the cooking shows that are around. And it's almost, with the chefs, that world still exists, where there is a kind of a level where you go, I need to earn my stripes. I need to just pay my dues. And you know, it's a great honor to be with this chef or that restaurant or whatever it may be in order for me to get to it. But you kind of know your place. And so I don't want that to sound old fashioned, but you know, we live in a society where people maybe want to run quickly, or they want everything quickly. And there are certain things, and I think hairdressing is one of them, where you kind of have to sort of pay the dues a little bit. You have to work hard, and it's not an easy one. I mean, most of the time, my biggest problem at that time was getting the last bus home.
Yeah.
You know, it was, you know, I didn't have the money to be able to do that, but, you know, to get taxes and things like that. But, you know, I wanted to do well. It was as simple as that.
And you've spoken about that in interviews, about having to go and shoot at 2 o'clock, and that's just something you just felt like you had to do. How do you think about that?
It wasn't even that I had to do it, I wanted to do it. It wasn't about, well, am I getting paid for this? Or what time am I getting home because I'm going out? It was like, please just let me be there. Mm-hmm. Let me have my foot in the door. I just want to immerse myself in this stuff that's going on. And I think if you see or read about the most successful people in any business, and obviously hairdressing or the beauty business is what I know the best, most of the ones that are really, really good really have done their sort of groundwork. They, you know, it's because they love it, and it's because they love that, and they want to just find out how this works or that works, or you know, they just want to experiment. And that's kind of pretty much, there's very few people that I know that wing it and have become that successful for a long period of time. Now and again, it happens. Now and again, you get somebody that is just naturally gifted. But most of the time, you have to kind of work for it.
So, during those early years, what did you feel like at the time was your big break? Was there a time when you were like, I've made it because that's what it was that I wanted and you got that?
Well, I never ever thought that. I mean, to be honest, it was, I never went into hairdressing with that in mind. In fact, I never went into hairdressing with the idea that I would have my own thing. For me, the thing was being able to turn up every day and work with young-minded people. You know, and they weren't young, all of them, but they were young-minded. This was an industry that allowed people to more or less dress as they wanted. You know, have these kind of ideas of what they wanted to do, whether they wanted to show their creativity in the photographic world or other aspects, you know, was there. And I think hairdressing has done that in the sense that it isn't just about salons. It can be. It's about salons. It could be about the trade side of it, you know, the best show that's meant to win. You know, there is the theatrical side of it, there is the editorial side of it, there is all of that aspect of hairdressing that is a very, very different thing than just necessarily being in the salon. You know, but it's kind of what you, whatever you want to make of it, you are kind of, you know, the owner of your own destiny.
It sounds so multifarious, which is interesting because did you think that you were always going to be in hairdressing, or have you made it such a versatile thing? Because you are an entrepreneur too, so.
I don't know. I went in just to do hair. It's what I do now. It's I go into a salon and I do hair. Mm-hmm. And I think people are still kind of surprised at that. But I don't personally want to give that up. I mean, I might cut my days and only be there 3 days a week now, but because I'm doing other stuff, but I don't really want to give up that. What I like is I like the thing of interacting with people, and those people can be from quite a, you know, a range in terms of the social scale. But I quite like that. I like the fact that there is no, there's surprises every day in terms of what I'm doing.
And you must have worked with many different types of people, some of them less awkward, some of them more awkward. How have you found navigating that and working people out?
Yeah, I'd like to say that I've worked with a lot of awkward people, but it wouldn't be true. And actually, I think that it doesn't help to say that because actually people want to be able to learn from that. But, you know, I kind of pride myself on trying to communicate with people. The last thing I want to be doing 10 times a day is getting that thing where I kind of go, well, I'm going to do this. And, you know, and then you go, da-da, and everybody goes, I don't want that. I don't want that surprise. I want to talk about it. You know, I want to go, this is what I think. This is what I think we should do. I even draw sketches and stuff. You know, I think it should be like this, it look like that. If people bring in pictures, I go, yeah, that's great, but that's not so great. But, you know, that's I don't have this thing where I've got to be in charge. You know, I've got to be sort of, you know, dictatorial about it. So for me, how bad is it going to be? Somebody might go, oh, I loved it last time, but it was a bit short. You know, that I wanted it, or you left it a bit too long, or, but it's going to be minor. It's not going to be, oh my God, I hate that. Do you know, it's not that sort of kind of a surprise. We kind of roughly know where we're going.
So how much artistic input do you feel that you have in your work?
All of it.
Yeah.
Because it's your job to be doing that. I think it's in the same level that you don't want to be this dictatorial person. I also don't want to be this other person that goes, oh, what are we doing today? What's our departing? Should we do it like this? Do you want some product in there? It's like going to the doctors and them asked to tell you what prescription to do. So it has to be a balance. And it's, you know, there is a two-way thing going on. And whether that's the person sitting in front of you or whether it's the film producer doing, because you're doing the look for a new film, or it's a magazine editor and it's a spread or whatever it may be, it's a dialogue. You know, you kind of, there isn't a power play going on. And very often it's one of the things that I know that really gets people in trouble. I see it with people in salons. I see it where, you know, I remember somebody saying to me, oh, he had six people to do it. It was all like, they all wanted the same thing. So we deliberately changed it towards the end on somebody. I went, that's a terrible thing to do. Because you're doing that to one individual. It's like going to see a play and you've done it 20 times. So you're just going to change the script. But the person coming there, it's their first time. So there might be times when you're repeating yourself. You know, it's really the same thing in terms of if you're part of a team doing, you know, if you're doing a shoot for Elle or Harper's or something, you know, it might be that it doesn't require you to be anything other than just do slick back hair. You know, you don't have to keep proving yourself every time. And that was something I learned very, very early on. You know, there was always that thing as the young kid. The model had straight hair, I made it curly. If it was curly, I made it straight. It was almost like I wanted to impress everybody. But actually, the great ones, just great hairdressers out there, they just want the picture to be great. And they don't mind if they take a back seat. And now again, they don't take a back seat. You don't want makeup artist, photographer, model, the clothes stylist, hairdresser, all trying to vie for position. Do you see what I mean? So I think it's about understanding the mechanics of how things work.
Yeah. And talking about that and having to go with what people want in front of you, if you were looking now for an intern working in your company, what sort of traits would you want from someone who is sensitive like that and can see what the person in front of them wants? So what are the different things?
It's very, I mean, I'm going to be flippant on this. turn up with your mother, you're not getting the job. If you ask what time lunch is, you're not getting the job. If you ask how much you're going to get paid, you're not getting the job. Now, that's me being flippant, you know, but there's an element of truth in it. Now, I don't have to interview them, so I would probably still be working on that level. But I know that I want somebody that says that sentence that I did before. Just let me get in the door. You know, you let me get in the door and I'll prove to you how great I'm going to be. I'm really not interested in all the other stuff.
Yeah.
So, because there are tons of people that just fall by the wayside. And if you're not committed at that age, you're never going to be committed.
No.
You know, there are plenty of times later on where you have a mortgage, you have the rent to pay, you have kids to bring up, you have school fees or whatever it is that you're doing. You know, there are plenty of time to do that. That part of that, you know, when you're at a certain age, you just want to do. That's all you want to do. That's what, I suppose, I need to see that, you know, from somebody that just wants to be. And it's not that easy sometimes. I'm going through it now, where we had a guy who was terrible people skills, but I still see his Facebook stuff. And boy, is he turning out some great work. He's turning out really, really good work that he's just doing himself. He's just doing, you know, pictures and stuff. And that's a tricky one, because not only have I not employed him, but I have employed him, and he really wasn't that great in the people skills.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm kind of going, are we a bit harsh there? I don't know. I mean, so there is that, and I've done that a few times where I remember when we were doing a lot of the shows, and we had a young girl who was just genius, applying herself to things. You know, she'd be perfect on all the kind of, you know, the big runway shows, you know, the Queen ones, where you needed to be, you know, to have that kind of discipline. But she was terrible in clients. I mean, it was just like she was losing clients. But she went on to become great in that field. So I suppose sometimes you have to do a whole bunch of stuff to know what you are good at and what you're not good at.
And back to talking about the fashion hairstyling. You've been in this business for quite a while now, and you must have had to adapt a lot to the changing fashions. How have you found that? Have you found that you've had to make great concessions in your work, in your art?
No, not at all. But I mean, the thing is, the first of all is if you love what you do, you're part of the changing process. I mean, you know, the real big difference, I think, is just in terms of the way products have changed things. Yeah, because when I started in 74, there wasn't any products at all, nothing at all. There was hairspray and some goopy, whatever it was. And if you look at from a hairstyle point of view and you study your history, you've got everything that is kind of, that is very, very smooth and flat. You know, what came from Vidal in the 60s was everything about coming from a point. But when it got to the point of the mid part of the 70s, you know, with the products, being able to mess around with sugar and water and shellac and stuff like that, we learn how to defy gravity.
Yeah.
Now, that gravity, as in that time, became very, very edgy. It wasn't commercial at all. So if you think back to, well, no, you might not be around, most of you, but, you know, Moose didn't come out until 1981. So, you know, and it was rubbish as well. So weak. So, you know, you have to get to a point that you've got kids on the street knowing how to defy gravity. And if you then look at that, you can see that very, very early part of the 80s, with the start of power dressing and Dynasty and Dallas and all of that, was the start of knowing how to do big hair. Because we'd taken that thing from the streets and actually learned how to do it in a commercial way. So suddenly we could go this way. Everything else, always, whether you've got bobs here or Farrah, everything's flat because you don't know how to defy gravity. You see what I mean? You can put body in with, you know, by setting it, but you don't know how to defy gravity. So that was probably the biggest change, you know, in terms of, you know, the wets, as we call it. And I think for me, in my sort of editorial career, especially, I suppose, through the 80s, which was when we were really, really starting to do stuff, most of my learning curve, which, you know, when John and I were doing pre-frizzing stuff, was really about actually, how do I get this hair to do this in this picture? And how do I get it to change from that to that very quickly? Because I, you know, we're going to shoot 6-8 pictures a day. I need to change it. I need to go this is really the kind of, I mean, it's about this much of it. I mean, you'd appreciate that there's tens and tens of thousands of images. So we put a bunch of them together just to give a kind of a flavour.
Someone can maybe dim the lights. Maybe.
Somebody drop the lights. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really, really important fact now that we have that as being such an important part. I'm not sure that we do it really, really well, and I think it's something that we probably have to start doing a lot more. And I think we, like anybody else, have to move with changing times. We're very, very fortunate that we have an incredibly solid use it a lot more in kind of our electricals, you know, with people that have got huge followers, that actually we can get across our message. So I think that it's a huge thing that I'm still learning about, and I've got a number of people, including my own kids, that are topic. 30-year-olds, that are teaching me as well.
And going back to this, sort of gun to your head kind of question here, who was the best person to work with?
Oh, gosh. That's difficult because there are, you know, the ones that I'm a fan of, and unfortunately, I'm still a fan. So, you know, it's not necessarily the best work you're doing, but for me, I'm a huge David Bowie fan. So to be able to do his hair for a period of time, and people like Brian Ferry, who for many, many years, I mean, it was like, these are kind of major parts of my growing up, my, you know, people that I love musically. But, you know, from a people person, most of them are really, really lovely. I mean, yeah, I think Yasmin Bond probably has a soft part in my heart, because I've known her since I'm 16 years old. So, and I still say that, there's one of the pictures there, where people say to me, out of all of the pictures you did, you know, which is the favourite, and it is one of hers. That's one of the things that came up earlier on, and it really came about on a really strange session, because it was sometime in the 90s, and I had the legendary Isabella Blow, who sadly no longer with us, who was doing styling for me, and she brought along this brand new person's collection called Alexander McQueen. So we had the brand new collection of New Queens. She brought along people like Stella Tennant and Lucy Ferry and all of that. And we were doing all these pictures. And it was one evening. It was just a general thing that I used to do all the time, just get people together, just to shoot. And she said that, you know, Jasmine's bored and Simon Hill, you know, she can't make it tonight. But actually, look, if you want, she'll come on Sunday. And I thought, okay, well, that's fantastic. So I just said yes. And you know, yeah, Yasmin came in, and it was the power of a great model that we had the picture within minutes. It was just that thing. This is pre-digital, and the Paul, our photographer, was working on motor drive with a small 35mm camera, and it was just, you just knew every shot. And I look back still, you know, at the old film, and it's kind of great. It was just this thing of somebody that knew how to, you know, just to be. And I think it helps that she's one of the loveliest people that I've met as well. So I think that probably helps. But other than that, the rest of it is just where I'm a fan, you know, to be involved with, you know, the new Batman thing with Christian Bale was, you know, to do Bruce Wayne, to do that look, that's a kind of an honor. To be involved with the James Bond stuff, that's an honor. Do you know what I mean? It's like, I'm still a fan. And I think, hopefully, that kind of excitement comes across. And I think that's, and it is an example, because it's, because I kind of go, my God, not only did they forget to credit me, but I never got paid either. And you think, oh, but it's like, you know, to be part of that is just, you know, just fantastic.
In an industry that's so dominated by women, at least from the client perspective, has that ever been difficult for you as a man? Have you ever encountered much prejudice from your position as head, from
Well, no, because it's the other way around. What I get asked all the time is why are there no female Nicky Clarks? And actually, there are a few, actually, but they're not necessarily household names. And, you know, I have to honestly ask that it's when we start, the intake of juniors, if anything, is probably more women than men. I mean, I like to try and keep as much of it as 50-50 as possible, but the truth is, most of the time, it's more women. So there's no reason other than the fact that their priorities may change, whether that be in terms of having children and stuff like that. We've had all sorts. We've had people that have taken their maternity leave and come back. We've had people that have had their children, and really their priorities have changed, and they don't come back. But so I still say it's really part and parcel of how somehow successful somebody wants to become. Because within the trade, there are some fantastic women hairdressers that are considered to be to be up there. So I don't encounter any of that.
And how flexible, supportive is your organisation with your staff for maybe women that want to take some time off, or even men who want to take paternity?
We've never had the men for maternity leave one yet, actually. But I mean, it's not a huge size business. As far as women, yeah, we've had a lot. In fact, the problem is when it happened recently, and I think in Birmingham, example, where we had four at one time. And actually, there was an impact from that point of view. But it's really about, I think, is people's choices. We've got one girl, for instance, who did do it the first time, but the second time decided not to take as much time off. Because it's all very well, but actually what happened is she takes the time off, and then there's a clientele that are going to other people. So there is an aspect of nothing to do with anything else other than the fact that you can't force people to go to somebody else. So I think that it's really about, look, you do whatever you want to do. You know, we make the environment as easy as possible for people to do, but I think people decide themselves how they want to do it.
As you yourself have mentioned, you have kids. Did you find when you're having them that in any way impacted your career, or was that just quite a seamless thing?
Well, it did slightly, because my wife was running the business, and my kids then, when we opened in 91, they were only 3 years old, was born in the mid-80s. So yeah, I mean, I think there was certainly, I think anybody that starts in their own business knows that it's really not, you know, a bundle of roses in the beginning. There's an awful lot of planning and deciding whereabouts you want to prioritise your time. And I think, and we were living actually just round the corner from here. It was just in Tupper Park, you know, Dublin Road. And we were there for 20 years. So it was kind of, there was a juggling process. But I think, again, if you've got two people driving towards the same aspect, you know, if we were very, very hands-on, I think the kids probably ended up in the saddle a lot of the time.
Yeah.
but yeah, we made it work.
So you're born and bred Londoner, and you've been for a long time. Maybe you want to just jump back a little bit, talk to us a bit about your experiences when you were growing up in London. And so you have a Greek father and an English father. How did you find that?
Well, I mean, I think most kids don't know any different. You know, that's the thing. You know, you live in whatever you live in. I mean, the house that I grew up in, you know, when I say it to people, there's kind of almost like shock horror. But we didn't find it that way. It was a two-bedroom house with no bathroom. And when I say two-bedroom, my parents have been one of them, and there were eight of us. So, you know, it's quite a lot, six children. But we loved it. I mean, I don't remember there being anything other than a kind of being a bit cramped now and again. But you know, you took yourself off to the public baths, and it had to be next door to the library, so it just became part of your routine. And so, yeah, for me, sounds like some kind of rags to riches story, but it didn't feel like that. I felt that I had a really good childhood. You know, I went to the local primary school in Yalkett Road, and I was fortunate enough. I think I was the last intake of what was the old 11 plus. So I went to a grammar school, again in South London, and it was fine for me. I mean, it was, you know, it worked very, very well.
And have your family and parents, have they always been supportive of your work and your success? Have you found them?
Yeah, I think the thing is, in the beginning, it was probably not considered the obvious choice. My father, actually, who's no longer with us, actually ran what is now the Tate Modern. It used to be Bankside Power Station. And in fact, actually, it's quite funny because there was a Channel 4 documentary on me a few years back, and just before my father died, and they very kindly opened up the building. And for me, there were early memories of the turbines, because, you know, I was born in the late 50s, so the early 60s, the big place was where you had all your Christmas parties and stuff. So they would put all those kind of long tables, and of course, colour TV wasn't around then, so the idea of seeing, you know, cartoons on projections and stuff, you know, it sticks in the memory. So, you know, so I have very, very fond memories of that time, and I don't consider myself, you know, to be hardships at all. And I think having a Mediterranean mother, it certainly felt, it was odd sometimes, because we ate what was old food. Not very odd now. I mean, pasta is a national dish, but it certainly it was in 1960, you know, or 1945 when she started. You know. But we knew we were slightly different, but not that different.
And talking about your industry, the Nicky Clarke industry, so you truly are an entrepreneur. What traits do you think define an entrepreneur?
I think you've got to want to have a go, and I think you've got to accept the fact that you may well fail. And I think failing is part of it. For every big success we've had, there's a few failures behind it. And you know, whether you're doing, you know, electricals or the wets, you know, shampoos, conditioners, or whether you're doing salons or whatever it might be, you know, there are things that we thought, well, that's a great idea, and it wasn't. Mm-hmm. But you know, fortunately, there's enough other good ideas.
Yeah.
And I think if you're serious about that, people will trust you as a brand as well. And that doesn't come lightly. You have to spend time at it and be consistent.
If you could change one thing now about your career that you might have considered to be a mistake or not have worked out quite as you intended it, what would that be?
I would have been more dictatorial. That sounds terrible. When we opened something, I don't mean it that way. I should have been more what's the word I'm looking for? Just comfortable about my own convictions. Whenever I look back at whatever I thought my gut feeling was, it turned out to be that's the one I should have done. And very often, you know, I wasn't that confident. So, you know, I tended to do things very consensually, you know, asking lots of different people's opinion. And actually, it didn't always work like that. So there's a lot of stuff in the beginning that I go, I wish I'd have just said, this is how it's going to be. And you either work with it or not. And actually, I've learned that most people would have felt more comfortable with that because they wanted to have some kind of leadership in some way. They wanted to know where their boundaries were. And it's only now, when I look back, that what I did with the best intentions to kind of encapsulate everybody into it becomes a bit of a, you know, a shambles. You have to have some direction and some leadership. And I think from that point of view, I would have changed some of that. I mean, we did it to a certain extent, but I would have been a lot more confident of what we were achieving in the first 5 years.
And on the other hand, what are you proudest of? What is the thing that?
Well, certainly the day we opened the salon, it was pretty special. Because I'd never owned anything before. I think that was kind of special. I think obviously, you know, being recognised, whether it be by your peers, by the industry, or by the Queen, as you say. So, you know, always holds a special place. But in the end, the thing about it is going in and somebody going, oh, I really love that, or you're a genius, I mean, or whatever it may be. You know, there is that one-to-one thing that hairdressing gives us. You know, there are, you know, and tons of great jobs out there, but there's not many where you get, within a relatively short space of time, you get to do something that somebody's pleased about. You know, you're not working for years on this research or that research. It's all about you and that person. You can do something quite powerful, or whether you're creating an image or a picture or something, it's very, very tangible. And I think from that point of view, it is why I love this industry.
Now I'm just going to wrap up with a final question, so everyone get ready to ask your own. Talking to these young people here today who are just starting out in their adult lives and their career, what advice would you give to them if they are, if something that they're each driven about doing, what would you advise them?
I think the thing is, it's easy to be kind of flippant, but to me, one sentence encapsulates it all. And you know, I always say, the harder you try, the luckier you get. And it's as simple as that. You know, you're not going to get it right all the time, but the more you keep trying at something, the more likely you are that something is good is going to happen. And, you know, we don't know if it is, but to me, I want to go out, I want to meet people, I want to surround myself with people that are good at what they do, whether it be, you know, tinters or photographers or makeup artists or stylists, I don't know, whatever it might be. I want to surround myself with people and I want to be interested. And I think, you know, lots of times people say to me, you know, is it about natural talent or is it about being taught? And clearly there's a bit of both there. But I know so many people that are really lazy, lazy hairdressers, but they are blessed with a talent. So, and that will take them to a certain point. And I know lots of people, in fact, I think John Friend was probably one of them, one of the people that it doesn't come naturally. But he was one of probably the greatest hairdressers of all, you know, of all. I mean, certainly that period of the 70s and the early 80s when, you know, he was really very, very creative, one of the greatest in the world, you know. But I don't think, looking back, objectively, I'm looking at somebody who was naturally gifted. He just worked damn hard, you know. He worked out every aspect of how to do stuff. Stuff that we still see today is partly part of that. And there are lots of other hairdressers like that, that I don't necessarily love the final part of their work, but I totally admire their work ethic to get there. And then, you know, you have to say there are people like that. There are people that just, you know, are into the pure aspect of our craft. Yeah. And I think that that's great.
Yeah, so just work hard, that's great advice.
I know it sounds like a bit of a cliche, isn't it?
No.
I think it's work hard, but with a certain interest.
No, yeah, I think that's the best advice you can give, really. Well, thank you very much, Nicky, for chatting with me. That's been really great. And now I'm going to open up the floor for anyone that might have any questions for Nicky. Don't be shy, I'm sort of dying to ask things.
Is there any aspect of hairdressing that you find annoying?
For instance, something that you find.
I'm still learning.
Right.
I'm still learning, but
I kind of don't really, because to me it's about creating something. So you could say that what's annoying is that maybe you're not being allowed to, you know, really vent your creativity. That might be seen annoying to some people. It isn't to me, because I actually don't mind if I do a little bit or I do a lot. So all I'm interested in is that, yeah, that end result looks great. And so I think trying to latch on to what different people's aspirations is, I think, where the key is. I mean, and if, whether I'm working on an 18-year-old who's kind of some edgy street kid, or I've got a 70-year-old country dowager duchess, it's all about trying to get onto their wavelength. And I want to get onto everybody's wavelength. So there are some people that don't want to get onto something. They just want to stick and be a little bit more niche or narrow, and there's nothing wrong with that as well. And I think that if there are things that are going to annoy you, then you might want to steer to the bits that where you're going to keep yourself interested. But I think from my point of view, I like all aspects of things. I mean, there are probably things that I'm not as good at as some of my peers, but I like to think that I've got a pretty decent handle on most things. I think the thing is to be interested. You know, we have tons and tons of information out there and images out there. You know, you have a better chance of doing that than anybody else. I mean, you know, for me, it would have been trying to get as many of the big fashion magazines, you know, so that I could be inspired. Whereas actually now, we can see an awful lot of that in terms of, you know, what's on, you know, online and stuff like that. So I think be interested and know what you like and what you don't like. And I think that's probably one of the most important things. I also, for me, I'd like to have to know where my reference points are. So, you know, the 20th century was a wonderful, you know, 100 years for, you know, the art of hairdressing. And it doesn't make any difference that we're not necessarily out to do retro looks, but very often, knowing how something comes about and applying it into a modern day feel, and hopefully we saw some of that going on there, is a great thing. So you have a wealth of stuff out there for you to be able to look at and to be influenced by and kind of know where you like to be. I mean, it may well be that you know you want to be doing very, very avant-garde, you know, cutting-edge stuff, but it might also be that you want to be doing, I don't know, old-school Hollywood or, I don't know, something like that. I mean, I've done it with my staff a couple of times where once a year we get the juniors to present, and we take a big studio and we let them present, and I give them a subject matter. And I remember one year we gave everybody each a decade, from 1910 all the way up to, and it was fantastic. We tried to get it that too many people didn't get the obvious ones, but it was great where they took their reference points from. Some of them were very obvious, some of them weren't so obvious. So that was great. You know, the ones that took the 50s might have taken, I don't know, Audrey Hepburn or whatever, but there are others that took some really, really far-flung stuff, and that was kind of interesting. And they put their spin on it. You know, they did it in a modern kind of way. So that was kind of nice. So I think, you know, arm yourself with as much information as possible. You know, that and being interested and working hard is a pretty damn good formula. And also, actually, surround yourself with people that are interested. That's a really big thing. You know, surround yourself with people that love what they do. You know, remove all that negativity around you because it's too easy to get into that one. You know, the fact is, it's very, very easy to end up somewhere that you think, oh, this is not really what I want. This is, you know, I'm not achieving this. You know, people around you, you don't have to do that. You don't have to do anything, you know. You can be on your own if you want. So, but be interested. Well, I mean, when that's a good question, actually. When I talked about the pictures that we did, an awful lot of the pictures that we did were ones that I instigated. And trying to get hold of the photographer, the makeup artist, the stylist, and things, actually was more difficult then than it is now. Now, there are online sites where everybody is very happy to give their services for nothing. They all want a picture. And actually, even that's easier, because the picture, you take it off the internet, it's very easy, it's very cheap. It used to be much more expensive, because it was the photographer that was putting most of the bill. Do you know what I mean? So from that point of view, I would say, surround yourself with those kind of people. I mean, it's almost what you're doing is you're giving yourself a kind of a foundation aspect to it. When you get out there, and there are no rules here, you could be all of those things if you want. When you get out there, that's quite rare for somebody to be that good at everything. You know, there are hair and makeup people that are pretty good, but they're not the best. The best makeup artists in the world are makeup artists. The best hairdressers in the world, you know, hairdressers. However, there are a lot of hair and makeup and they work every day. Because if you're doing a trip or a catalogue job and it's in Australia or Spain or wherever it is, it's cheaper to have the one person. You know, and so very often it used to be a makeup artist who could do a bit of hair, but actually there are a few now that are hairdressers that can do makeup. So it depends on how it goes. But I've never actually known a photographer. But I do think it's a good idea from your point of view to know what it is that's going on. And I've worked with probably the greatest photographers in the world, from Mario Testino to David Bailey to whatever it is, the best photographers in the world. I mean, I don't know exactly how to take pictures, but I've got a much better idea of the composition of what I want. So although I don't rarely take my own pictures, I do work very, very closely with somebody when, and I'm literally here with the camera, you know, next to it, so I'm seeing what there is. And so to create the images that I want, you know, I have a photographic head on even though I'm not necessarily taking the picture. So I do think it's a good idea at this stage to arm yourself with lots of that. Good luck. That's a really, really good question. I mean, the answer has to be, it depends on how good the person is. And it depends on how good or how varied that person is.
Did you learn from John either?
I learned from John, and John is a identical copy of Leonard. Leonard was a very famous hairdresser in the 60s with Vidal, but they were almost the opposites. Leonard was, Vidal was a very structured modernist, you know, that had his main period from 63 to 66, and what we know of the 60s, that whole element of black and white and modernism and Bauhaus and all of that thing that he brought to hairdressing actually was not the second half of the 60s, which was Leonard was king. You know, here we had somebody who was much more fluid, and of course we had, you know, Summer of Love and the whole hippie thing. So it lent itself to that time. And John was a product of Leonard, and I was a product of both John and Leonard. So from that point of view, these were two people that were very good at pushing the boundaries. And, you know, I learned so much stuff from them. But then I look back, and I know when Trevor Sorby joined us for a while, I learned a lot from him. I learned from going to the trade shows and seeing a lot of the avant-garde work. When Guido Palau was with us, we did a lot of the shows from McQueen to Givenchy to Calvin Klein to all of those things. So there was a lot of, I mean, I had a background in running anyway, but I learned a lot again. So I suppose if you have the ability to surround yourself with different people, then I think it's great. But if that one person has got an open mind, then, you know, you need to try and take as much as you can. That statement is the one that I've probably heard more times in my career from people that are learning. I mean, and I always say that period of time when I started to learn in the mid-70s, you couldn't get it more diverse. You know, I would have somebody teaching me one day a Sassoon-type method and another day some other method. And there is no answer to it. Everybody's going to bring their thing, and you have to take from that what you can, and rather than looking at it being confusing, just absorb it and, you know, and go with it. And then as time goes on, you will start to see which of those are the best for you. And I look back now and I've taken so much from people in my past that weren't actually necessarily some of the most considered famous or fabulous hairdressers, but I take bits. You know, you become a magpie, and you go, oh, I take that from that, and that from that. So I wouldn't see that as bad.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. Have you ever made a mistake of doing a cut here or coloring while you're not finishing? And how did you fix it? Along with your
first reaction? This is another one of those other questions where I would like to say, yeah, we had this terrible time when I did such and such, and it was 25 years ago, and we did this, but I haven't. And I don't have a story like that. I mean, I remember a time when, frog in my throat. I remember one time when I was very, very early on and learning, and we started by the first few weeks with just really doing one length base cuts. And the person that came in, which I thought was going to have a one-length trim, wanted a complete redo. And I freaked. So I didn't actually do it though. I just went and hid in the toilet, which was a terrible thing to do. And I remember actually John was the teacher that time. And he didn't say anything the next day. He must have forgotten. But he said, what happened to you? And I was like so embarrassed. He said, that girl was sitting there. 2 hours. Because I just hoped that somebody else would have done it. But it was more that I thought, I'm going to screw this up. I just wasn't ready for that. But I suppose that goes back to my thing of, you know, I want to be prepared. So I'm not doing something that random that it's going to be that different. I'm not, whether it's colouring or cutting, you know, I pretty much know how it's going to turn out. Having said that, now that I just remembered, it wasn't a mistake, but it was. I remember doing. doing Kate Beckinsale's many, many years ago, and the very, very first film she did, she was an unknown, it was a film called Shooting Fish, and she wanted to have her hair cut really, really short. And I actually put it on, and the producer for the film came in, you know, that's what Kate wanted, so. And I did it by gradually, and I thought there was a point where it was kind of short but long enough that it was kind of, you know, looser that I preferred, and I thought it was great. And she said, no, no, I want short, I want short. And we got it to that point. And the thing is, Kate's grandfather is from Burma, so she has that slightly oriental hair that you don't really see. She wears it all longer. But when it's short, it goes bang. And I can remember just thinking, oh my God. And I remember we even permed it to put a bend to it and all that. I mean, I hated it. I mean, we did it, the film came out, everybody loved it. Even Vogue went, this great new haircut that Nicky Clarke said. And I hated it. I hated the whole thing. And she came in about 6 months later, and I thought it would. It was just, it all grown, and I was going to get it back to Mike. And she made me do it again. I said, you've got to be joking. I said, you've actually got to be joking. I hated that. And she made me do it again. And I think the answer is, nobody has ever seen her with anything other than long hair since. So I'd like to actually think that we kind of, you know, I was right. But, so that wasn't, it was a mistake, but not a mistake, really, I suppose. Sorry. Don't have anything else. Not, you know, no sniffing of the ears or, oops, sorry.
Anyone else? Any questions? We've got quite a lot of, at the college we'd like to promote with our learners the importance of doing work experience and working in industry while actually on qualifications. So a lot of them really try to go out there and try to get employment. However, our adult learners really struggle. So a lot of sons are not willing to take adults on as juniors, providing advice to students on what they could do.
I mean, we have taken adults on this journey. In fact, I would say that I think three of my most successful, four actually, of my most successful stylists that were adults. Craig, who actually is with me now, actually was an Olympian, actually. He was one of the gymnasts. When they came fifth. So he gave it up. He'd been a gymnast since he was nine. So he didn't come to me until he was in his late 20s. The thing is this, it's not usual. However, having said that, very often somebody that's slightly older doesn't want to hang around and they become slightly more dedicated. So when I think back to the four or five people that we have got that started when they were older, then I think that from a business point of view, it's actually been a success. It costs more, it costs more for a business to do that. So from that point of view, but you have to weigh it up. You know, what you get as a 16, 17, 18 year old that doesn't have the social skills necessarily, you have that side of it. You also, if they don't know anything, you have an easier sponge for them to either unlearn bits and do it your way. But then on the other hand, somebody that is older, has normally got the social skills, really doesn't want to be hanging around on a junior's wage for that long. So tends to apply themselves a little more successfully. So it works both ways. Any more questions? Good. Well, I hope you've got... Sorry, what? Oh God, I hope I never reach my peak. No, I don't, because the thing is, I think if you get to a point where you think that you've reached the peak, then you're going to kind of go into automatic pilot. And there's no doubt that there are days when you might be able to do that. I don't think you can do that for very long. I think people kind of see through that. And I think also, as you get older as well, you almost have to prove yourself a little more, that you're kind of, you know, interested in what is going on. And I am thoroughly interested in what's going on. So that must kind of come through. It must kind of be there. So I don't just want to be this kind of, I've you know, I want to be part of it. I mean, and I have the difficulty of, I mean, I'll give you an example. I had my portrait taken by Rankin the other day, and I'd never met Rankin before. And it was just, it was a bit like kind of, you know, he was saying, what do you do shoes then? And I go, well, I don't, because nobody asked me to do them that often these days. If it's a big old celebrity, yeah, they ask me, because they think I've got the weight behind doing it. But I would just love to just be part of that thing. He said, okay, that's fine. We'll do some stuff together then. So, you know, so I have to deal with that side of it, of people going, oh, it's a bit grandiose, and he's going to come with an entourage and all of that. When I just want to be one of the team. Yeah, so, but you've got to want to be part of that. So, no, I have wish for being there. Still a lot to go.
Should we take the last one over?
We live in a free market economy, but I think that local councils might have something to say about whether it's the same thing. However, hairdressing is one of those kind of different things. It's not like having loads and loads of shoe shops where you think, well, actually, it's quite good if they're all in the same place because people then go there. I don't think that necessarily works with hairdressing, but it could work to a certain extent. I think, you know, for me, it's all about trying to just be above everybody else. And I think once you take everything above that, it doesn't matter whether you're on a high street or whether you're in a back street, you know, and you become a destination salon. You know, if you do good work, the, you know, word of mouth will get around. It's as simple as that.
Talent obviously plays a big part in the work that you do, but how important is networking? How important is the element of knowing people to be able to get that word of mouth?
You didn't know me at all. I mean, I would say from the photographic side of things, it helped me because obviously I was working with major magazines as an assistant, so that helped me. Doing clients, working in a salon that was attracting certain clients because of that, that helped me. Personal networking, I never do it. I mean, people think I'm at a party. I mean, I don't go out. I should really do more, probably. Did I do it in the early days? No, I was doing 15 clients a day, 7 days a week, so 6 days a week. So, but I think the answer is probably yes, because we talked about it before, surrounding yourself with good people or like-minded people. So I think networking doesn't always have to be a dirty word from that point of view, but did I do it? Not really. I mean, I didn't do it that way. I didn't, you know, it wasn't like I knew people to invest in me or anything like that. I got a government-backed scheme. So he then went back to university and did his economics degree. And then he came out and came back to us and set up a lot of the website stuff and stuff like that. But I think in the end, you know, both of my kids have got economics degrees and they're in the world of finance. And so from that point of view, I think it was a bit tricky because my daughter's first paycheck was 6 figures, mine was 12 quid. So she's very talented. And I think he probably just saw that. So they're both in the world of banking. You know. So the hated bankers. Yeah.
Okay, anyone else? No. Okay, well, we're going to have a chance now to have some refreshments and do a bit of networking with Nicky ourselves.